Hello students, welcome to today's video. Let us continue with our lesson 4.1, History of English Drama. After a few years from Elizabethan and Restoration Theatre, we have the Modern Theatre. Now, Modern Theatre with its picture frame stage, actresses taking female parts, its movable scenery designed to create a visual image of the local of each scene, and its artificial light was developed during the Restoration period. We can see clear influence of France in theater, the audience, and the themes of the dramas. The drama of the earlier 19th century was on the way to decline. Why? Why was the drama on the way of decline? There were few reasons. Due to irregular spectacle, that is visually striking performance. There were not very good performance in the early 19th century. And then we had melodrama. What is melodrama? Melodrama is a sensational dramatic piece with exaggerated characters and exciting events. So such kind of drama was presented. And there was farce. Farce means a comic dramatic work with ridiculous but amusing behavior of character. So this was just very much different from the drama which was before the 19th century. As we have seen in the previous video, before 19th century, that is during Elizabethan and Restoration period, we had drama in which the people, the audience, could relate to the characters, their behavior, their acting, and their situations in the drama. But in the early 19th century, all these things were not present, and so the audience were not very much interested. Apart from that, there grew external reasons, and that was due to the monopoly held by two houses. That means these two houses only started organizing the drama. That is Covent Garden, wherein today we have the Royal Opera House, and Drury Lane. So these two houses started having performance of serious drama. So the audience which gathered to the 19th century theater did not have intelligence or imagination of the Elizabethan audience. You see, my dear students, drama or being the audience of drama is not possible for everyone. We all might not have the knack of, you know, going to see the drama, or we might not enjoy seeing dramas. But in the Elizabethan period, the audience enjoyed it. It was, you know, really very good for them to go and sit down and see some drama, okay? Because they had that intelligence to interpret the behavior, the character, the setting, and all the other elements in the drama, okay? And also they had this imagination where they could go and, you know, flourish those thoughts through the acting in the drama. But the 19th century audience did not have all these kind of characteristics, and so they did not enjoy the theater. It was unreal to the life of time. Now, like we said, in the Elizabethan and Restoration period, they had some real situation dramas, okay? The dramas which depicted the real life of the people. But in the 19th century, all I said earlier, they had only melodrama and farce in which there was nothing real. Everything was unreal and so, you know, superficial. So they did not relate to those kind of dramas. And also, the structure of society was changing, okay? The way people were, the way they were behaving, their occupations, their interests, all those things were changing. And this had also modified the human personality. So a new interpretation was essential. So during this difficult period, we have this great Norwegian dramatist, okay? He belonged to the 19th century, and his name is Henrik Ibsen. Now, he developed modernist, realist, social, and psychological dramas. And some of his dramas are The Doll's House, Ghosts, and Enemy of the People, and so on and so forth. Now, these dramas that he, you know, started writing, They were very much subtle in stagecraft. Stagecraft means skill or experience in writing plays. So very soft, very subtle they were, and they had profound, they were profound in thought than anything in the modern English theater. Okay, so like in the modern theater, like we saw that everything was so superficial and not real. So here he started making those changes. But it was only George Bernard Shaw who was deeply influenced and affected by Ibsen's innovative contributions. Okay, there were so many other dramatists or playwrights, but they did not understand really what Ibsen wanted to change in the drama that existed during this time. But only George Bernard Shaw, he started understanding, and he was one of the most brilliant playwrights of his time. Okay, and he alone understood that Ibsen had something great in his mind, and he was determined that plays should be a vehicle for ideas. See how beautiful he thought about, you know, the idea of having play. It's a form of literature, drama. So he wanted to convey as much as possible through his plays. And he said that my ideas can travel to most of the people through my plays. Okay. So he started writing dramas in those manner. Now, the responsibility of elevation means raising the standards of the English drama, okay, to the brilliance of Norwegian, Ibsen, okay, Henrik Ibsen, how he thought, it was only with Oscar Wilde and George Bernard Shaw. So these two playwrights only understood the necessity of rising the standards or rising the bar of the way the theater and the drama was presented during that time. See how beautiful he says, Oscar Wilde. He says, we are all in the gutter, aren't we, children? We all are in some kind of situation where we want to get out from. But there are some who are looking at the stars, and there are some who look down and see only dirt, okay, or bad things. So when you look at the stars, your attention is completely towards something great, even though you must be in the bad situation today. Okay, so these are the things that we need to learn from these great minds. Now, after 19th century came the 20th century drama, and here the drama started being revived. It was started being revised, and Oscar Wilde, he started writing witty comedies, okay, some brilliant comedies, and one of the examples is The Importance of Being Earnest. Then you also have George Bernard Shaw, who wrote comedies to criticize virtues of all societies, okay. So he started writing about so many things that the society needs to think about. And one of his plays, Pygmalion, which is based on musical comedy, My Fair Lady. Okay, so we see that there were so many more playwrights who explored contemporary problems in the society. Then we also have the drama being then changed and revised after the 19th century, thanks to the new playwrights and their ideas. They were the most important dramatists. There are many much who are like, you know, W.B. Yeats, then J.M. Synge. They are all very important dramatists who used a sense of tragic irony, a violent species of humor, and a rich and highly flavored language was used during their period. Then we have dramatists like T.S. Eliot, who experimented with Greek tragedy in the early 40s of the 20th century. And other dramatists of the modern era like John Osborne wrote on people who grew up after the Second World War. You see, during this time, this kind of incident or this historical change took place, okay, in the society. And after the Second World War, what kind of situations and what kind of mindset people started having, all those things were covered in his plays. Okay, then MS wrote about frustrated anti-established young people, because you see, after this World War, many people's lives were devastated, and so these young people who started coming, you know, emerging during this time, they were very much frustrated, and they were not established, they were not settled, they did not know what to do. So Osborne's look back in anger brought a new vitality to the theater scene. Okay, then we have so many other playwrights like Anton Chekhov. Here you can see. Then you have Eugene O'Neill. Then we have Tennessee William, and we have Samuel Beckett. All of them contributed a lot to the modern era of drama. Then we see, since we have seen the modern era of drama or the modern theater, let us look at the theater in India. So the Indian theater can be the seeds of Indian theatre, like the origin from when it has been started, is found in Sanskrit dramas, okay? Because we belong to the country of, you know, sages and all these great people. So Sanskrit dramas have been practiced or have been played in our country, that is India, from the 1st century AD. And we can find the proof in, you know, Mahabhasya, which is a drama by Patanjali. And he, this drama is like, maybe it can be said as the beginning of theater in India. Okay. Now, how do we get to know about this? Is from Natya Shastra, that is a treatise on theater. Now, what is treatise? Treatise is work written dealing formally and systematically with a particular subject. Okay. Of course, so this must be about drama. So, Natya Shastra, which is written by Bharat Muni, is the most complete work of dramatology in the ancient world. Okay, so Bharat Muni, we all might have, you know, heard his name. So, he was an ancient Indian theatrologist and musicologist who wrote Natya Shastra. Now, what is Natya Shastra is, you know, a treatise or the written record on ancient Indian communication in Sanskrit literature. So, he's considered as the father of Indian theatrical art forms and first communication scholar of the world. So this kind of book that he has written, it gives mythological account of the origin of theater. So we see that modern Indian drama, even today, looking at the various forms, has been influenced from all over the world, as well as Sanskrit and Urdu tradition. So I'm sure, my dear students, you have understood how the drama has been evolved from right from the beginning, okay, throughout the world, and it continues to change. There are so many changes that are added, you know, with new situations in our lives, and drama has been progressing and reaching greater heights as and when the times are changing, okay. So with this, we shall end about the formal information about the history of drama. In the next video, we'll get to know about one act play. What is one act play? What are the various characteristics of one act play? So until then, please do read through this part on page number 131, 132 and 133 in your textbook. And we'll soon meet again with one act play in the next video. Until then, thank you and have a nice day.